Okay. Welcome to the Deliverance Center in Arizona. People from Minnesota, can't believe the weather. They're at polar opposites. 113. If you're planning a visit here, replan it. It's going to be super hot August. Probably our hottest August we've ever had. One year I was out here, it was over 100 degrees at Thanksgiving. Do you remember that? It's over 100 degrees at Thanksgiving. That's weird. All right. Hey, let's take a hard target look at the Word of God tonight. I'm doing a couple of teaching series. Where'd you get them at? Well, I just made them up. One of them is Satan's Secrets. Secrets he doesn't want you to know. And the other one is Learning from Others. So I thought I did that last week, so I thought I would try it again. We're going to learn from some of our Bible friends. Steve? Phil? Simon? And we're going to visit the Skiva family. See how they're doing. All right, our next seminar is on August 30th. It's on divine healing. I like to do that seminar, you know, at least every year and a half. At least once every year or year and a half or so. I need to get that one out there. I'm on the radio every day of the week and twice on Sundays and once on Saturdays on 10 a.m. I'm on 24/7 on the radio on Omni FM. You can pick that up off the website. 68,000 listeners last week on Dark Sky Radio. That's a secular internet radio station. I'm also going to be doing podcasts there in a couple of months, so we'll see if that's going to work. If you'd like to donate to the ministry and you don't have any money, you buy stuff on Amazon, no problemo. You just go to Smile Amazon, put in our ministry name, and they'll donate to our ministry every time you buy socks, you know, underwear, hats, or whatever you buy, anything you buy. Tonight's Bible study will be replayed on our healing channel on YouTube, number one, House of Healing Izzy. All right, there's our self-deliverance list. Anybody need one? Anybody need one? They're great. They make great Christmas stocking stuffers. You put one of these in a Christmas stocking shelf, you will be the bomb at your Christmas dinner with your relatives. Oh, they're going to like you. Send me an email and I'll send you one. You can get delivered at home. There's the three books I wrote. They are in the bookstore. How to Get Healed from Mental Illness, How to Get Healed, Divine Healing, and Satan. The flash drive is now ready. If you want to go through a deliverance training course, you can pick it up off the website now. 18 sessions with live deliverances at every session, showing you how, teaching you how to do it, and then showing you how to do it. It's the only teaching like it in the United States that I know of. You can be taught and then see it. That's very rare. It's in the bookstore. Thursday nights, Rick's killing it with the healing room at 7 p.m. And I think there were several people here last night for our mental illness healing class. Okay? Please refer us some people who are mentally ill. Don't let them sit at home suffering. Okay? There's no charge. It's free. It's free because you donate. See? And you donate on the website. Grazie. All right, I'll be on Omega Man Radio this Wednesday again, having another unusual show. All right, this is my Learning from Others series. The best way to learn things is to learn things from others and then try it out. That's the best way to learn. That's how human beings learn best. Yeah? In the Bible, it warns you to going around from house to house, learning, ever learning, but never coming to the knowledge of the truth. There are some Christians, most of them, they love to watch stuff and learn stuff. Oh, it's great. They go to church. They hear the pastor. They go to Bible study. They go to home group. Then they go to YouTube. Now, after you're all done learning that stuff, the net result is nothing. It's nothing. You're ever learning, but never coming to the knowledge of the truth. You're learning, learning, and learning, and learning, decade after decade, and then after 2 decades, you're sitting there screwed. Why? Because that's not how human beings learn. They learn by doing. Here's how you take out a spark plug. Hello, Motorcycle Mechanics Institute. Over here. It's spark plug day at Motorcycle Mechanic Institute. Here's the book. Read the book on this. Now, let's go into the garage. Now, take it out. Now, look at it. Is this too deep for...
No.
You read the book, then you go do it. That's why a trade school is better than a college. Why? Because the college is theoretical acquisition of data that you're not using. Why do they not do that in medical school? You read it in medical school, then you go on the floor and commit malpractice and you try it out. Okay? Hello? One of my wives years ago was a nurse. She went to nursing school. She came home one day, honey. When I hear honey, I go, oh, shoot. I heard honey. Oh, honey means Mikey's in trouble. Honey, you know what I learned in school today? No, I don't. I don't. How to do IVs. Honey. Can I borrow your arm? Whoa, there was no whiskey in the house, no nothing. No, you ain't borrowing my arm without Jim. Beam. She wanted to practice God's honest truth. She wanted to practice IVs on me. What was she doing there? Something good. She was learning it in the book. Then she was applying it on her loving husband. Okay. That's how you learn. More importantly than learning like humans learn best in the spirit world, it's even more important. It's more important than Motorcycle Mechanic Institute. Read a spark plug. Read a tune-up. How do you do a tune-up? Now let me show you how to do a tune-up. There you go. Take that tool. Here's the tool. You put it there. Then you turn it here. In the spirit world, it's far more important.
Yes. You're right.
And God uses the same procedure as a trade school. He teaches you something, then he wants you to go try it out. Because there are demons, okay, the demons aren't hanging around over at Motorcycle Mechanic Institute panicking because somebody's going to learn how to do a tune-up. They're not interested. They don't care about a tune-up. They want to damn your soul to hell. They're in another plane. So they fight you every step of the way. So they talk you into learning from every preacher and every teacher you can get your hands on. Oh, they're everywhere. Click on that one. Click on this one. Read that. Read this. And that's how you get all these different doctrines popping up. And this one contradicts that one. This one contradicts that one. And before you know it, you've got the entire church all jacked up.
Yeah.
Amen. Yes, sir. Is this too real for you folks?
No.
You want something theoretical? Yeah. Thus saith the Lord. Now listen, I don't do that kind of teaching. I do regular person teach, real life teaching here. That's how I'm built. I don't do the other crap. I could teach in the courts of heaven. That's not going to help anybody. God teaches you something. Then he wants you to go out and try it out. The demons then follow you while you're trying it out. Not tuning up a car. They don't care about that. They care about spiritual things. So if you make a mistake, they jump all over you. Oh, you're a failure. My God, you screwed up. You're a screw up. You failed. You're a failure. Then they personalize it. They use your failures against you. Why? They want you to go back and study some more. Oh, yeah. They want everybody to be a big brain. The brain for Planet Eros. I saw that when I was 8 years old. I was scared. This brain from Mars would float around and get into people. Nobody saw that because you're not an old person like me, but I saw that. Came out in the 50s. The brain from Planet Eros. It was an actual movie starring John Agar.
Yes.
Who in God's name is John Agar? Nobody knows. Who cares? But what the Holy Ghost is doing is using your failures and loving them. Good, you did exactly what I wanted you to do. You read here and you went out and tried it and you failed. High fiving you. Okay, now read a little more and try it again. That's how the Holy Ghost works. He works through failures. Every person who wants to be in the ministry. Is there any person here who has no interest in ministry? Just raise your hand there. Everybody's interested. So this teaching is going to go over like a bomb. In order to be used in the ministry, you have to be trained. You don't just wake up on Tuesday morning and go, man, I got the gift of healing while I was napping. I'm going out into the world to heal, be healed. You nuts. Of course it doesn't work like that. Come on, man. You got to be trained to be in any kind of ministry, particularly a Holy Ghost spiritual ministry. Well, those conclude my introductory remarks then. Learning from others. Okay, Acts chapter 6, let's go. In those days, when the number of the disciples were multiplied, this was during the revival, there arose a murmuring from the Grecians against the Hebrews. The Hebrews were Hebrew-speaking Jews. The Grecians were Greek-speaking Jews, right? During Pentecost every year, they had a big celebration, like they have New Year's or something. Once a year, Pentecost, boom! Everybody flooded into Jerusalem. In Louisiana, during Mardi Gras, everybody floods into New Orleans. Same thing in Jerusalem. Everybody coming from everywhere to Jerusalem for Pentecost, celebrating the harvest, right? Now, what's the devil do in every big gathering, every move of God? 100% of them. What's he do? He plants seeds of murmuring in every revival ever known to man. Every revival in the United States has been quenched, quacked, cooked, clobbered by, these are all Greek terms, by what? Seeds of murmuring. Every one of the revivals. Azusa Street.
Right.
Clunk. Murmuring got into the system. Welsh Revival. Murmuring got into it. It got so bad, the guy running the revival cracked up. ended up in a mental institution. Murmuring are the seeds he uses to destroy any revival. What kind of revival? Anyone. A revival at your home group. A nationwide revival. What doesn't matter. Doesn't matter what it is. He tries to get in these little seeds of murmuring. And murmuring brings with it injustice. This group feels they're being unjustly treated by that group. And by God, justice for all. Yeah, that's America. Justice for all. It's the biggest bunch of cock or crap I've ever heard of, but that's the theme here in America. Justice for all. This is injustice for everybody here in America. And so as soon as this person starts to think they're being unjustly treated, they have a series of reactions. Some of them are violent, some of them are frustration, some of them are depression, some people quit, some people fight. Depending on what your personality type is, you react to be treated unjustly. Went over it last week in the teaching. This parent treats that child better, and that way it's unjust. So the widows, the Greek-speaking widows, were considered persona non grata to the Jewish Hebrew-speaking widows. See? You had a series of cage matches with a bunch of widows. That would sell out on pay-per-view. Why? Because they were neglected. You see, they were showing favoritism. Went over it last week. The parent who favors this child over that one, we went over it in detail last week. The same thing happens in a revival. Injustice occurs. So this thing starts to manifest. See? So the 12 apostles called the multitude of disciples. During a revival, it's the greatest thing in the world, everything's accelerated dramatically. People grow fast. People learn fast. People develop their giftings fast. Everything we do is hyperventilated, hyperactivated in a revival. Everything, instead of puttering around in an Uber, boom, it's a rocket. So these people were quickly being made disciples. They were so eager to learn. Aggressive repenters. Here in America, repentance is a four-letter word. There, they were glad to repent. People were repenting left and right. The way they think, the way they talk, the way they act. No problem. It's a revival. I'm a God seeker. See? In our society, we are God draggers. See? We're trying to drag the saints to the altar. We're trying to drag them to repent. Drag them to forgive. In a revival, everybody does it naturally. Oh, they're down at the altar and repent and went crazy. Wigglesworth came to town and whole families would leap over pews to run to the altar. I went to the Pensacola revival and this nasty preacher named Hill was there. And he gave an altar call, and people were running down to the front to repent. They ran down there to repent. Amen. What was this guy doing, preaching a prosperity? No, that crock of crap, he didn't do that. He preached sin and repentance. People were, I saw him with my own eyes, running down to the altar to repent. I saw it. Don't tell me it didn't happen. I was there. I saw it. Oh, Brother Mike's back on the whiskey. I'm not. I don't drink anymore. I repented. Repented. But I have an orange juice. Oh, people. Hey, this is ridiculous. We're being bogged down by these disputes and this yik-yak and mick and mouse. And hey, we got to go with the revival. So we got to set up another system here. Brilliant. Brethren, look out among you. Find seven. Okay? Find seven. With these qualities. Read it carefully, please. It'll save the rest of your life. I'm saving the rest of your life right now. If you have any interest in ministry at all. You got to have the Holy Ghost. You have to have an honest report among others. Okay? Talk is cheap. I'm honest. When I was a secular counselor, I used to do a lot of legal work, and so I testified in court quite often. I testified over 200 times over the years. Social Security, workers' comp court, superior court, I'd go in and testify. Well, before you testify, you put your hands on your Bible. They bring it up, and they lead you through an oath. And it was a total joke. Everybody in court lying like crazy. They don't care about an oath. Nobody did. I saw it. Don't tell me I didn't see it. I saw it.
Amen.
It's just a perfunctory behavior. Nobody cares. Winning is all that matters in court. Nothing else matters. Winning. And I was good at what I did, and usually I won. You know, I won over 80% of my court cases. Nobody wants an autograph. Well, great. You got to have an honest report. You can't just say, I do. You have to show it. Yeah. Honesty has to be shown to others. Talk is cheap. TV preachers talk all the time. Blah, 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 blah. It's all cheap crap talk. Talk is cheap. You have to be living like that. So if somebody sees, hey, this guy, this gal, they're honest people. Here, they said, find some people who are not just saying they're honest, but they live like they're honest. And they have wisdom. We don't want somebody here who's struggling to tie his shoes. You can be an honest person and not tie your shoes. You can be an honest person and be a big dummy. Do not raise your hand and pour a point to a relative. They wanted people who were honest, had a reputation of being honest, and had wisdom, godly wisdom. Follow it? See the requirements here? These were the requirements that you will need to just start learning and being trained for ministry. Not to get in the ministry.
Thanks.
You're not qualified to get into the ministry because you're an honest person. That's a prerequisite to start training in the ministry. Find me seven guys or gals. Men. Find me seven men. Here it says. Fix this thing. So who'd they choose? This is what you have to have if you want to go into the ministry. The training program, not the ministry. This doesn't qualify you to be in the ministry. What I said earlier qualifies you. You study and learn, then you try it out. Then you fail. You're supposed to fail. It's part of the process.
Right.
Then you try it again and it fixes. Then you try something else and you fail at that. Then you try it again and it fixes. And pretty soon, after a few years of training, you are now a very dangerous person to Satan.
Amen.
He knows you've been trained to fight.
Yes.
Because you got into the training program because you were an honest person.
Yes.
Ah. If you're not an honest person, you'll end up on TV selling boxes and books and programs. That's all a crock. They're just making money to make limousine payments. And somebody's got to make a mansion payment. You think they're going to make it? No, and heck no, you're going to make it, fool. Full of the Holy Ghost. Why? Demons have wisdom. They have knowledge. They're smart. That's why he said full of the Holy Ghost, not full of spirits.
Yeah.
Eh? You have to have these three things. I want you to write them down. I want you to memorize them for the rest of your life. Wisdom. Godly wisdom. Filled with the Spirit. An honest reputation. not just verbiage. I'm honest. I do. I will. Promise to tell the truth. I will. You ever see a presidential inauguration? What a fiasco that is.
They put their hand on this.
You promised to defend. Yes. Can we get to the end? And then they start doing their work. Oh, my God. And then hell comes to breakfast. They swear in every one of those people in Congress. Did you know that? They've all sworn in. That what they're really swearing to is, I will lie to you 24/7. That's what I'm swearing to do. But I can't tell you that because it's politically inappropriate. These three things are what you have to do just to get into the training program of Holy Ghost greatness. Don't ever forget it. Why am I saying that? Because people try to get into it without these three things, and they shipwreck, to use Paul's term. Okay? We will give ourselves continue to the prayer and ministry of the word. Everybody agreed. So they chose who? A bunch of Greek-speaking Jews. That'll teach them. All of these names are Greek names. Why? Because it was the Greek widows that were getting hosed. All right. You know them, right? Stephen, Philip. Remember these names? The rest of them, we don't know anything about. So I put a couple things in there that we knew about them, but nobody really knows what ever happened to them or who they were. But we do know they had the three qualities of training in ministry. There's three things you have to have to get into the training program. Correct? Those three things. They had them. All seven of them had them. Okay? And then it says, they set before the apostles after they picked them out, and they said, hey, these are the seven guys that have those three qualities. They got the Holy Ghost. They've got godly wisdom. Uh-huh. And they have an honest reputation. They're not just honest. They have an honest reputation. They have the two combined. What does a reputation require? It requires a track record, not just blah. I'm honest. You know. That don't mean nothing because somebody says they're honest. They put their hands on them and they anointed them for God's work. Bang. Problem solved. Murmuring did not destroy the Jerusalem revival. It got the guys at Azusa. It got the Welsh guys. But it didn't get the Jerusalem. They cut the devil off. That was his poison pill, murmuring. When somebody gets a gift from God, a battalion of spirits flood in the door in that church, and they don't attack the person that has the gift. They hit everybody else with jealousy. Look at that. And pretty soon, this person who was doing the right thing, praying for a gift to help other people, God gave it to them because they had an honest character and an honest reputation. They had the Holy Ghost and they had wisdom, so he gave them this gift, whatever it is. Suddenly, nobody can stand the person. Jealousy causes you to eventually hate the other person. They disgust you. Yeah. They leave this normal person like you were and where you were receiving them as normal. Now they have this gifting, you ain't got it. So the demons come to you and say, well, they don't deserve that. Well, that's favoritism. God is a respecter of persons. He's as trashy as you people are. My God, I can't believe it. So then resentment builds up in the other person. Well, wait a minute. Now this person's got access to the pastor that I don't have. I had a good idea as they did. But I'm not getting in the door, but they're just welcomed in. You people don't go to church at all. Okay, well, anyway, the churches run in a hierarchy. There's a hierarchy in every church, a small one, big one, doesn't matter. You know, you got your the people out here who are the ones that support the whole darn thing. And then certain people gravitate into certain positions in the church, and they're looking for access through the system.
Right.
So if you get a gift from God, there's going to be other people being jealous of what you're getting. Okay. And it didn't happen in this revival. They beat it. Okay. This pattern can be replicated now.
Amen.
Then it says here in verse 7, the murmuring got cut, and guess what happened? Boom! God's word took off like a rocket. Thousands of people being healed. Jerusalem went from a Jewish city to a Holy Ghost city. And the priests were getting filled with the Holy Ghost. That is the greatest miracle of all. That would be like the president of the Mormon church falling down, speaking in tongues and resigning.
Wow.
That'd be like a pope going, "Oh my God, there is a hell. Hallelujah."
Wow.
That'd be like a pope getting saved and repenting. Can you imagine that?
Wow.
He said, "Man, I just got filled with the Holy Ghost. I can't do this anymore."
Wow.
The priests were getting saved. The priests hated Jesus. Come on. This is a real revival here. This is hardcore. Okay. Stephen then enlists in the training program for the gospel of God. He got in because he had three qualities. Bing, bang, boom. What were those three qualities? Excellent. Now he had to enter the training program. What was that? Serving.
Amen.
Holy crap. Serving? You gotta be kidding. What are you? Come on. I wanted to be on TV. I wanted to be on the pedestal. I gotta be. No, God doesn't do that, sir. You go into the training program after you meet the qualifications. There are three. Then you enter in the servant program.
Yes.
Then you get to clean up vomit from kids at the revival.
Yep. Right.
They're all eating their curds and whey. Who's going to clean that up? Stephen went over and cleaned it up, never said a word.
Yes.
Why? Because he was training for glory.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Stephen would sweep up the crap.
Okay.
The ministers wouldn't. Oh, we don't do that. We ride in a limousine. Okay, ride in a limousine. That's good for you, but if you want the Holy Ghost, you get out of the limousine and then you go clean up some vomit.
Right. Yeah. That's right. That's right, sir.
Stephen would say, "I'll set the tables. I'll put this over there. I'll pick that up. I'll clean that up. I'll fix that. I'll drag that out. What's that, trash? I'll take that trash out." See, Stephen knew wisdom. He was in a Holy Ghost training program.
Amen.
What training program? Well, let's see. He entered it and then graduated here. Stephen, full of faith, verse 8. He's no longer serving tables. You got to clean up all this crap before you do that. See, in our churches, it's a miracle to get us somebody to act like a servant. That's the miracle. Here it was signs and wonders. There it's, you mean you're going to clean that up? I don't do that. I'll have my wife do it. I tried that with my current wife. Oh, well. I repented. I had a period of pride come over me. Foolish move. Foolish move. Stephen, now graduating out of his program, he had the three qualities, an honest reputation. He had godly wisdom. Huh? And then he went serving, picking up trash. An apostle picking up trash? I can't believe it. You can believe if you understand how God works, not how churches work.
Yes. Amen. That's right, that's right, that's right.
See, God works differently than the church works.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Excuse me. Stephen went through, not the church program, a Holy Ghost training program. He got saved and repented of his sin. He stopped lying and cheating. He became an honest person through conversion and his baptism of the Spirit. He changed in his heart and in his character. Is that good enough for the ministry? No. But he added to it godly wisdom. And then he said, what can I do to be in the spotlight? No. I'll just take the trash out. I'll clean the toilet. I'll pick up the crap. I'm trying to help somebody. And then when God saw that he had changed inside after he had become a Christian, Stephen, he could now trust him with the heavenly riches. Because he'd been picking up the earthly crap. Taking out the trash. Picking up the garbage. Cleaning the toilet. Uh-huh. Yeah, this is unknown to you folks. Great teaching. God said, I can trust this boy.
Yes.
With my real power.
Yes, yes.
And then he graduated from serving tables to serving souls of men.
Yes, yes, yes. Amen.
None of it would have ever happened had he not submitted to God's training program. Not the church training program.
Right.
You've been to Bible college? You go to seminary? No, that crap doesn't work. This is how you get trained for a Holy Ghost ministry, if you happen to be interested. If you're interested. If not, well, we love you anyway. Dunamis is supernatural power. It took no supernatural power to empty a trash can or pick up some spilled food or fill up somebody's glass again. It took no supernatural power there. That was training. That was training for supernatural power. Once he could be trusted, God gave him supernatural power. Dunamis. That's what it means. Terrace, wonders. Shocking healings and events happen. People go stunned. Wonders. Oh, what was that? No, cleaning a toilet. You don't need any wonders to clean a toilet. No, no, no. You need to be able to block out the smell, maybe. You need to keep stuff from getting on you. There are certain skills to cleaning the toilet. But one of them isn't dunamis, supernatural power. You don't need that. But you need it to get it. You need to clean the toilet to get it.
Yes, sir.
They don't teach us that in Bible college. See, they don't teach Holy Ghost stuff in Bible college. That's all head stuff. That's all head stuff. ever learning but never coming to the knowledge of the truth. What is the knowledge of the truth? This is how you become a monster for God.
Yes, sir.
Not getting a degree. Is it a sin to get a degree? No. Hey, if God wants you to get a degree, go ahead and do it. Then go into this program.
Yeah.
That should have landed. He did what? He did great wonders. Poieo means to practice them. He was doing them repeatedly. He was practicing supernatural power, great wonders, and Simeon, miracles, supernatural events for the people. Why? Because he had gone through the training program. He entered the training program, meeting the qualifications to get into trade school. Then he learned while he was in trade school. Then he graduated and went out and started doing tune-ups for motorcycles. Correct? You got to have an entrance exam to get into the motorcycle training school. What is that entrance? They got it. Can you read? Okay, prove it. You got basic math skills? Prove it. You take an entrance exam. To have a Holy Ghost ministry, you got to take an entrance exam. Are you an honest person? Do people recognize you as an honest person?
Right.
Do you have God in you? Have you filled with the Holy Ghost?
Right.
Are you? Well, then you met the requirements to get in, but not to minister.
Right.
Devil will chew you up and spit you out at both ends. Yeah. You don't want to get spit out at that end with the devil. That's near the end. See, a lot of these jokes are just for me. Then, what happened? Okay. Somebody noticed you graduated from the Holy Ghost school. Believe me, the devil keeps a track of that. He don't care who's graduating from computer school. He's not that interested. You get through the Holy Ghost school, you will draw in some attention.
Amen.
Somebody will notice you quickly. They noticed Stephen. And the devil said, oh my God, we can't let this guy get loose.
Right.
He got away from us when he got saved, because he changed inside. He developed some honesty and some integrity and some character. That's something not too many Christians have, unfortunately. Then he entered this training program over at the revival. He was serving people, filling cups, getting them food, taking care of the widows, cleaning up slop, throwing out the trash, cleaning the toilet. While he was doing all that stuff, the Spirit of the Lord was watching every step he made. Click, 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 watching. Watching him, watching. Whoa, wait a minute, this guy's ready to graduate. See, what you don't understand is the Holy Ghost wants to graduate you faster than you do.
Yeah.
Because the world's going to hell in a handbasket. He needs people out there now.
Amen.
But because he loves you, he's not going to rush you through his training program. Everybody has to go through the same training program. Then, verse 9, all these people started listening to him and seeing what he was doing. He was causing a major stir at the revival. And all these people that came out from other parts of the other countries and other areas, they all came to the Jerusalem revival. Here's a list of the people that were at the revival. The Bible mentions them right here. And they all had their own synagogues in Jerusalem. So, if you were the libertines and you lived in Africa, you had a synagogue in Jerusalem, like a timeshare. And during Pentecost, right, or Passover or something, when you came from out of state or out of country, you had your own synagogue. It was always there for you. They all had synagogues. There are synagogues all over Jerusalem. Whole bunches of them. This is a picture of the great synagogue in Jerusalem right there. That's supposedly the biggest and the best one. I don't know anything about Jerusalem synagogues, but they're all over the place. See? Well, that was like that back then. They all had their own synagogues. Everybody had one. See? It was like a franchise in a way. Yeah, McDonald's in every corner. Well, they had them, and they were visiting there. They came there for the Pentecost. They saw Stephen, and here they are right here. Here's the list of them, where they came from. Okay? Who they were. Throw that up for the YouTube people. Okay? So they see what Stephen's doing, and they pitched a fit. They attacked the guy. Okay? Before you start your training program for God, you have to understand that this is part of your program. Amen. The training program at college ends when you get your certificate. You get sheepskin, see? I got a couple myself. I graduated, right? No graduation in God's school. You don't graduate till you drop dead. You are forever growing and learning the things of God. No one ever reaches the point where they know it all. It's impossible. It's impossible. Persecution, rejection in America, there's no persecution here. Rejection in America is part of your training program, and you cannot get away from it. If you do what the churches do and learn to kiss butt, you will avoid rejection. But I'm not talking about some butt kissing training program. I'm talking about a Holy Ghost training program, if you're interested. If you're not, we love you anyway. But if you're interested, you enter the program with three qualities. You go through the program serving. After you graduate, then the devil comes for you. And you have to learn as a graduate. As an undergraduate, you were learning to serve. Now you're having to learn spiritual warfare. Serving someone is not spiritual warfare. Hey, can I refill your cup? Can I walk your dog? That's a spiritual warfare. No, there are not a lot of fallen angels going to keep you from walking somebody's dog. They're not going to flare up out of the sky. Jesus, I can't believe they're walking that dog again. That's not going to happen. They know the devil don't come looking for you until after you graduate.
Yeah.
After you get your anointing. After you get your gifting. Then he comes looking for you. They came looking for Stephen. All these different synagogues, all these outsiders, they don't want to hear this. They don't want to hear this anti-Moses stuff. They don't want to hear it. But they couldn't talk him down. What happens when you can't talk somebody down? Well, look at politics today. You start attacking them. You trash them. You hit them below the belt. You say nasty things about them. You disgrace their manhood or their womanhood. If you can't outthink the person, then you destroy the person emotionally. It happens every night on the TV. Somebody's yelling and screaming and doing something. Because they can't outthink the other person. They make a point and go, oh, well, that did it. Boom. There, take that point. So the devil now is going to resort to what we're seeing on television every night. What? Violence. That's his ace in the hole. It's violence. Because he knows that God said, turn the other cheek.
Yeah. Right.
So they start heaving lies upon him. Okay? They couldn't out talk him. They couldn't out reason him. Why? He had Holy Ghost wisdom. They couldn't beat him with the word because the scriptures were being quoted and he was illustrating it and he was winning. So now they're losing on the base elements of the case. So now they got to hurl false accusation. Yeah. It's called a marriage. Have you ever seen two spouses yelling at one another? Don't raise your hand. But what happens is the yelling starts like this, la la la, la la la, and then one starts to get the upper hand because he or she got in a killer point. Well, you remember when you fell off the wagon and hit the disabled kid when you were drunk? You're like, oh, geez, you brought up the drunk disabled kid. So now the other spouse has it over on the other. See? So the other one's in a weakened position intellectually, being out yelled and out argued by the other one. He got in a couple good shots. Yeah, your mother's feet stink. That hurt. But then they came back. Oh, he fell off the truck drunk. Now he has to resort to getting nasty. Nasty. So they're going to heave lies upon him. They said he was speaking blasphemy. They heard him say all these horrible things and this and that. And they stirred up the people and the elders and the scribes. They all came upon him and they caught him. They brought him before the council. They dragged him down there. They said, hey, we heard him said Jesus of Nazareth is going to do what? Cataluo, dismantle this whole system. Everything we believe is being dismantled. We don't keep the law. We don't deserve the feasts. We don't go to Sabbath. What's he doing? He's wrecking everything. They all sat there in the council looking steadfastly at him. And all of a sudden, what happened? God pulls Moses out of his hat. He pulls Moses out. Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the lawgiver. He had the tent, and his face was shining like the glory of heaven. And God replays the Moses scenario to prove that he's supporting Stephen and to give them the indication, hey, I'm on Stephen's side. This Jesus you're talking about, he's the new sheriff in town. And boom, they were staring at Moses. Face was shining like the sun, right? And you know what happened next? Of course you do. He gives him this long, incredible sermon, which I didn't put in the teaching. It was spectacular. If you get a chance, please read that sermon again. It was really great. Sums up the history of the Jews and how Jesus went through the scriptures and became the Savior of the world. It's a fantastic sermon. 100% anointed sermon. Fabulous. Fabulous, to say the least. But after it was over, guess what happened? Then, Stephen, not being a TV preacher, where you got to keep kissing somebody's butt until they sign over their estate to you, you say or do anything you have to do to get them to cough the cash up. You know, the crooks on TV? Stephen is not a crook on TV. See, he went through the Holy Ghost training school. He entered the school an honest person to begin with. Then he served during his training period. The devil couldn't take Stephen out because he'd gone through God's training program, not a Bible college training program where you eventually have an affair with the secretary. Some of you aren't laughing because you're thinking, oh, holy crap, I went to a church and yeah, Bob did have an affair with. He then tells him to hardcore truth. There it is. All you're doing is resisting the Holy Ghost. I went through a Holy Ghost training program, and all you do is resist him all the time. You hate the prophets. You persecute them. You kill them. You know about the just one. He's quoting Isaiah here. He's quoting Jeremiah. This was an anointed message of staggering proportions. But you people are now what? What are you? You're betrayers. You're murderers. Okay? What was Stephen doing there? Well, he was working on his make friends and influence people pamphlet. No, he was doing what God told him to do, not kissing butts. He's fresh out of butts to kiss. See, when you go through God's training program, you don't knuckle under when somebody puts the heat on you. You don't change your story and act like a gutless hypocrite or a coward. You don't do that. You've been through your training program. You've already served. You've been at the bottom. The richest man that ever lived in America was a guy called John D. Rockefeller. If he was alive today, he'd be worth like $400 billion. He'd make, oh, what's that Bezos guy? Dave Bezos? What's his name? What?
Jeff Bezos.
Jeff Bezos. Jeff Bezos. He'd make Jeff Bezos look like a guy waiting tables. Bezos is chicken feet to John Rockefeller. Rockefeller started out working in the fields as a grunt. What's your point? It's clear to me, you got to start at the bottom in the Holy Ghost School of Ministry. To get into the bottom rung, you got to have honesty that people recognize. You got to have the Holy Ghost. You got to have godly wisdom just to get in to the floor. When you go through that program there, you don't fall apart under pressure. You receive the law by angels, but you don't keep it. Wow, what a shock that was. When they heard these things, they were cut to the heart. They gnashed on him with their teeth. What did they do? Being full of the Holy Spirit, he looked up into heaven and saw what? Jesus standing on the right hand of God. See, Jesus always sits at the right hand of the Father. That's the power position, sitting at the right hand. See, but he had to get out of the chair, the throne, and to go greet Stephen, come on home. Wow. See, when he got up to go get him. Hello. That should have landed. God sits on the throne. I've already done the work. The victory's already been won. I just sit here in my glory. But wait a minute, my man Stephen, who went through my training program, he entered the program an honest person. Then he was a servant and worked on the ground floor. He was a grunt in the oil fields. Then he worked it out. I could trust him enough to give him the supernatural power of the gifts of the Spirit. I didn't trust the other ones. I trusted him. And now he has fulfilled my call on his life. So I need to get off out of my throne here and bring my servant home. I saw him standing at the right hand of God. There. That did it. That drove everybody completely nuts when he said that. I see the heavens open, the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. He's normally sitting there. They cried out with a loud voice. They stopped up their ears. What? They ran on him with one accord. What'd they do? They drug him out of the city. They stoned him out there. Neanias is the Greek word for a person who's somewhere between the age of 20 and 40. So we know here in this chapter in Acts, Paul was 40 years or under at this time. They threw their garments over here, and somebody during a stoning always watched the garments. He had to have a garment watcher. Because after you stoned the person and killed him, he was the one that gave you your cloaks back. I got the green one, Paul. Saul, give me that one. Here's the green one. He didn't throw the stones. He was watching the clothes. So we know he was a relatively young man at this time. According to the Bible, when you stone somebody, the witnesses of the offense always went first, okay? So if somebody affronted your family or hurt the families were the first ones in line to throw the first stones. And you never did it inside the village or the city. You always took them outside, all right? There's Paul collecting clothing, okay? Had he not been the greatest Christian ever lived, he would have been a tremendous Salvation Army store manager. In Acts 7, it says they stoned Stephen. And he said, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And then Stephen's the greatest miracle occurs now. Of all the miracles that he did, all the signs and the wonders that he did, paled to nothing compared to his final miracle before he went home to heaven. His prayer was applied to Saul.
Yes, come on, sir.
Saul standing there collecting the cloaks.
Yes.
And Stephen's getting his head bashed in.
Yes.
And the last thing he says was, forgive the guy holding the cloaks.
Yes.
And God heard the prayer, got off the throne, brought his servant home, and then later on the Damascus Road answered Stephen's prayer. And Paul became the greatest Christian that ever lived. His greatest miracle was dying his prayers as he died. That's what I call getting trained, learning, graduating, and going home.
Yeah, amen.
That's right.
Wow. Can't wait to see him someday.
Amen.
Hey, let's check out somebody else who went through the same school. Who was it? Phillip. He did the same thing as Stephen. I don't know if they knew each other, but I pretend they did. They both entered the school together. They both were honest people. They had both repented of their sins after they got saved. Imagine that, a Christian repenting of their sins after they got saved. It's like a miracle. See, at Calvary Chapel, you don't repent anything. You just come down there. Oh, yeah. I'll say the sinner's prayer, and then I'll sign the card. Yeah, that's fine. Oh, and then I'll backslide later. Thank you. Unbelievably stupid. It's not how you convert people to Christ. If they're not convicted of their sins, and they're not broken before God, they're not going to get saved.
Right.
I'm saved. Yeah, that's like saying, I do in court. I do. You swear to tell the whole truth, nothing but the truth of God. I do. You fill this card out and say a sinner's prayer. I'm saved. I'm saved. Have you lost your mind? Has somebody lost their mind? Is it me? Am I nuts? Holy smoke. Saul was what? Agreeing to stoning him. That's what it means. Sooner to Kale. It means to agree with what they're doing, but he wasn't participating. Yeah, he wanted them to murder him. And again, guess what happened? Well, there was great persecution in the church. What did they say? Yeah. You get into the training program with those three qualities. You then go through the training program as a servant. See? You don't go through the training program learning how to put makeup on and stand at a certain angle in the camera and make a plea for donations. It's not how we do it. You go through a servant's training program, not a TV preacher one.
Right.
Then you are endued with power from God on high. Then you go into your ministry. You graduate into your mission, whatever it is. Okay, your ministry may be different from her. It doesn't matter. It's still a God ministry. Then you learn to face persecution,
yeah,
and you learn to spiritual warfare.
Come on, sir.
That's how you do it. Persecution was the shock of the revival. See, the murmuring didn't end the revival. God used Satan to end it for his purpose. He tricked the devil again. He's always tricking him because he's not omniscient.
That's right.
The Holy Ghost is omniscient. The devil isn't. Demons aren't. They make mistakes.
That's right.
If the devil had half a brain, he would have left them in Jerusalem because they would have just faded out on their own egos eventually. But because of his hatred, and because you can't control hatred, because hatred is the strongest, most vicious emotion known to man, he can't control himself. He hates people and can't stop it. So he attacks them. He attacked them. The Spirit of God said, oh, that's a nice move. I got a better move. Here's knight to rook 3. I'm going to move these hardcore Holy Ghost trainee preachers out to the other areas to win more souls. See, you don't understand, the trial, the tribulation, the crap you're going through is designed to bring you a victory later.
Amen.
Is God doing it? No, and heck no. He's watching it, and he's making the move behind the scenes because the devil don't know what he's doing.
Amen.
They were scattered abroad. Look at that. Judea, Samaria, everybody. The apostles stayed in Jerusalem. Saul did what? Wow, when he saw that stoning of Stephen. See, Saul never saw the vision. He didn't know what the guy was talking about. He assumed he was lying. And so he's just trying to make himself feel good. He's dying. He's getting hit in the head with stones. Yeah, I'd make up something too. Yeah, I go, oh, there it is. 72 versions. That's what he thought. He didn't know he'd actually seen the Son of Man standing at the right hand of the Father, reaching down to get him. He didn't know that was real. And then he prayed for him to boot. Saul went away doing what? Suro, dragging people out of their homes, killing them, putting them in jail. Saul was a type A personality. He persecuted the church. He murdered Christians. He was a demon-possessed serial killer, and he never got over it. That was the worst thing he'd ever done in his mind, was hurt God's children. He never got over it. He mentioned it several times in the scriptures that he had persecuted the church of God. It just wore, he never got it out of his craw. They were scattered everywhere, and they went around preaching the word everywhere. Okay, so then what? Phillip, who had gone through the same training program Stephen did, but God had a different purpose for Phillip. Stephen's purpose was incredible, praying for Saul, who then, we wouldn't be here without it.
Right. Amen.
Our salvations started with Stephen.
That's right.
Philip went through the same program. Honest, full of the Holy Ghost. Godly wisdom. Can I serve? I'll clean the toilet. I'll take out the trash. I'll listen to somebody yell at me. Oh, they're griping. I'll quell that dispute. I'll be a peacemaker. I'll mop up this crap. Here's some more to drink. Here, you need some more food? What can I do to help you? Philip graduated just like Stephen. God looked at him and said, hey, now that's a guy I can trust. He's like Stephen. I think they know each other. I'm going to give him what I gave Stephen. Only I got a different job for him, see? I'm going to use persecution to end this revival and get him out there. Stephen left the revival and went up there. Philip left the revival and went out there. Samaria. What was he doing there? Preaching prosperity or something? No. They didn't do that back then. Here's where he went. Here. There's Jerusalem there. There's Samaria. We're south of Galilee. There's Judea down there. That's where the revival was. He went into that area. They scattered everywhere, the Bible says. And the people with one accord gave heed to the things Philip spoke, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. This guy was a carbon copy of Stephen. Why? Because they were twins? No, they went through the same training program. What I'm teaching you tonight is a system that cannot fail.
Amen. Amen.
It is a system that works 100% of the time. It never fails. What I just taught you. Bible college, all kinds of failures. Seminary, all kinds of failures. Any other system? Chronic failures. Any system, name it. This system, 100% victory. Works every time. The other five guys, same thing, just wasn't recorded. God only knows what happened to them. Phillip, though, had an advantage. Jesus had already been to Samaria and had already laid the foundation of this one waters, this one reaps, God gives the increase. Check this out. Jesus had already been to Samaria and he had started a revival of sorts with a woman at the well. And Jesus says to the disciples afterwards, didn't I tell you that you have these months of planning and then the harvest comes? He said, listen, lift up your eyes and look. It's already harvest time. See, once you go through your training program, from there on in, it's nothing but harvest and spiritual warfare. Until he gets off his throne to welcome you home. Then it stops. It doesn't stop until then. Jesus had already paved the way for Philip, and Philip didn't even know it. He that reaps receives wages and gathers fruit to where? Eternal life. Yeah. Not material things on this earth. Oh, I got a mansion, I got a car, I got... That's all carnal crap. Those are carnal Christians that live like that. See, I'm not looking for a carnal Christian here. I'm looking for one or two or three people that want to go through this training program. Not some insane church program. People don't go through this training program, so few, because human ego. People have egos. They have a certain sense of themselves. Well, you know, I don't know. I'm sure. Those people do get into the church. They do get ministries. They drive the church bus. They do Sunday school classes. They substitute for somebody to preach and different thing, different kinds of things. But they never, ever really make any kind of deep spiritual impact. It never happens. They're just filling somebody's time. They're just puttering through, thinking they're doing something, but they're not. See, you don't understand when you meet a Christian and everything's going to crap for them, you're probably staring at an apostle. You think they're idiots.
Come on,
oh God, this is wrong, that went wrong. Financial trouble, that some this people but bailed on them. Oh, there's a foreclosure. Oh God, there's a bankruptcy. Yeah, you're looking at those people. Why don't these things right? Hey, you better watch yourself.
Yep.
Right. They could be going through some kind of training program that might lead to dunamis superpower. They all rejoice together. Sowers, reapers, God gives the increase. Bang, you win, you can't lose. Here's the saying true. Jesus said, one sows, another reaps. Jesus sowed, and Philip reaped. I sent you to reap where you bestowed no labor. Philip bestowed no labor whatsoever. He went through his training program in Jerusalem. He served. He graduated. He got loaded with Holy Ghost power. Then persecution scattered him to Samaria. He would have never gone there had that not happened. Sometimes God's got to force you out of your comfort zone. Christians hate that. Do you know why? 99% of Christians have their pants loaded with cement. And when they sit down, they aren't going to move come hell or high water. See, God might have to tip your chair over. I know what you're thinking. I'm not coming here anymore. Listen. God may have to let something happen to you that moves you out of your Christian comfort zone,
right,
which is really the kill zone.
Right.
If you knew anything about the military and knew what a kill zone was, you would have really reacted to that statement. Your comfort zone is actually your kill zone. That's where you go to die. Spiritually. Other men labored and you entered, Phillip, into their labors, Jesus. Right? Well, Phillip goes to Samaria and it says unclean spirits. Boao is the Greek word. It means to bellow. You know, not just cry or yell. It's long bellowing, I guess like a moose in a way. I've seen that happen about 100 times over the last several years with the House of Healing in here. In fact, it happened this week. People were yelling. And the way you handle those kind of deliverances when they're yelling like that, you take that finger, Holy Ghost, see those anointed fingers? You lift them up here. You shove them in there. And you wait till the demons yell their way out. Is this thing on? And you're fine. Took me 5 years to learn that. Yeah, I got hearing deficit in both ears now because I didn't get that from day one. Yelling, bellowing, blowing out of people. People were in the grip of Satan, in the grip of, possessed, in the grip of the demons. Many people with paraluo, spinal cord injuries, they were healed, right? Lame people, kolos is somebody who limps around, they were healed. And there was, why? Somebody else labored and you enjoyed the fruit of their labor. Jesus laid the groundwork with the woman of Samaria, Philip, forced out of Jerusalem, after he finished his training program, then went to Samaria and reaped the rewards of evangelism.
Yes, that's it.
What a story. Can you remember the story? Apply it to your own life, because God is going to put you in a position where you got to get out of that chair and get the cement out of your butt.
You're right.
And he's going to allow somebody to pull a rug out from under you.
Amen.
Somebody's going to not show for you. Somebody's not going to come through for you. You're going to have some tough times.
Yep.
Tough times. I don't even like to hear myself say it. God's going to move you out of your comfort zone. Why? Because he loves you and because he has all these people over here he wants you to bless. And you're not going to help anybody unless he gives you a nudge to get out of that comfort chair, which is your kill zone. That's where the devil, you're under surveillance, and then the military, they're watching and you don't know they're watching you. And then they're all dead. Like that. Literally in seconds. They're all dead. It's called the kill zone. Correct? Right? Anybody in the military? Great joy always follows people who have gone through their training program, who have been servants, who have been endued with Holy Ghost power. When the Holy Ghost comes around, man, there's incredible action. He's an action figure. Not the Avengers. The Holy Ghost, he gets busy. He rakes the devil over the coals, and then the people are thrilled. Right, ma'am? The arthritis lady there? She was probably very happy when she got here. That was a Holy Spirit healing. It had nothing to do with us. Karina had gone through some training here. Not going to go into it. It was tough. Okay, she didn't do that the first day she was here, correct? She had to go through a training program. Some of it wasn't pleasant. See, in church, The TV guy always wants things to be good for you, pleasant, likable, enjoyable.
Yeah.
You're a good person. You're sweet. See, that's all demonic crap. See? Had he had half a brain and really wanted to help you, he would forfeit the money and just kick you in the butt. Bend over. Yeah. Yeah. When I was in grade school, you bent over. The principal, the teacher, pulled out a paddle with holes in it. Bang! That thing hurt. See, the holes, there wasn't any, it wasn't slowing down. When God has to whack you like that, rejoice.
Amen.
You know why? He loves you.
Yes.
He remembers you. He's got a plan for you. It's a good sign to get a whack on your lazy fanny. Uh-huh. Yeah, that's Hebrew. Now let's get back to this. Simon, now let's switch over to somebody who wanted to go everywhere in the world but didn't want to go through the training program. Hello, can somebody help me? You got a training program, three things to get into it, then you got to serve, then God can trust you and he hands you your giftings in your ministry, whatever it may be.
Right.
Simon saw that training program and said, you got to be kidding, I'm not doing that. I want to take a shortcut to get to the big show. Okay? That's why they call it minor league baseball. They have a minor league where you play in the minor league before you go to the major league. Correct? Some players very rarely can skip the minor league and go right to the major, but that's not the rule, that's the exception. Very rare exception that a high school kid could go to the major leagues and get a hit off that kind of pitching.
Yeah.
It's not going to happen. But you give him 4 or 5 years in the minor leagues and he's got talent, he'll go to the major leagues. Simon, nah, I ain't going to the minor leagues. I'm already major league. I'm already there. See? Ego. I mentioned earlier, ego. There's a man called Simon who used a maguo. He was a magician. And he bewitched the people. Ecstasy means that people were, oh my God, it's unbelievable. Wow. You ever done that before? I have. I was watching Chris Angel on TV one time. And I couldn't believe what he was doing. He's an illusionist. It's all fake. But it's like amazing. How did he get over there? He pulled up a blanket, then dropped it, and he was gone. Where'd he go? I was existing me. Oh, what happened? How do you just disappear? See? People who have simple minds are fooled by that stuff. Yeah. He got me. So Simon goes, hey, I can do this. Poof, I'm gone. Whoa, everybody's, that guy's got God power. He was fooling everybody. They said, hey, that's our man. Let's listen to him because he's got great power from God. He's got power from the spirit world. He's the guy. But the reason witches and witchcraft demons manifest so fast is because when the Holy Ghost is around, they know they're going to get shown up.
Yes, sir.
They know they don't have it. They've been telling everybody they got it. But when he shows up, nobody has it.
That's right. All right. Come on, preach.
So they manifest and they try and make distractions.
Yes.
Ooh, they get all fussy. They get fussy. But when he saw Phillip doing it, even Simon said, hey, maybe I'm not in the major leagues. This guy's in the major leagues. I'm in the minor leagues. This guy's doing stuff I wouldn't even think of doing it. He said, I gotta investigate this further. Well, he started listening to the preaching and everything, and the Holy Spirit convicted the guy. And guess what? He actually got saved. He turned his life over to Christ. Simon believed also, that's the Greek word pistuo, it's the verb for pistis or faith. He believed and was baptized and continued with Philip. That's a typical behavior of a new convert. At least I hope it is. Philip was amazed. He watched Philip and he was amazed at the miracles and signs he was doing. Simon then kept following him around. Well, word got back to Jerusalem and said, hey, there's a massive revival going on in Samaria. So they sent down the two big guns, Peter and John. They were the top guys of all the disciples, correct? They came down and prayed for them they might receive the Holy Ghost. Well, because the Holy Spirit had not fallen on any of them. They all had the Holy Spirit, they just weren't baptized in the Holy Spirit. Baptized is different than being born again. Every born again believer has the Holy Spirit. They were only baptized in water in the name of Jesus. So they laid their hands on him and they received the Holy Ghost. Well, Simon's watching this and he's going, hey, that's better than my old disappearance trick. I'm gone. Wow, that's amazing. Look how happy these people are. He liked it. Okay? Nothing Simon did was wrong. Nothing Simon did was wrong. He followed Philip around. That's good. You want to follow a man or a woman of God who has knowledge and wisdom and who are humble and are good people? What's wrong with that? For crying out loud, go ahead and learn from them. Absolutely. Absolutely. He was amazed at the miracles. You're supposed to be amazed. The Holy Ghost is an amazing person. Yeah. Period.
Hello.
Dude. Yeah. Hello. Everything he did was right. But, oh no, the other people were getting delivered from demons, but Simon didn't. He never got delivered. What happened? What happens to every Christian? Their old nature manifests and takes over for a temporary period of time. Happens all the time. It's never not happened in a counseling session I've had. Hundreds of counseling sessions. All of it. These are all born again Christian. Most of them are spirit filled. But they never went through deliverance. So their old nature manifests and takes over. Is anybody listening? If your old nature is manifesting and taking over in some capacity, mentally, emotionally, physically, guess what? You haven't finished your deliverance. You're not done yet. You've got a little ways to go. Don't quit. Keep going. Simon never went through deliverance and he got caught with what? What he's been normally doing. He said, hey, you guys need money. See? I mean, they got to have some money to get back to Jerusalem. I mean, I'll make a donation. What's wrong with that? There's nothing wrong with donating money if you have a good heart and you're not doing it to manipulate somebody. If you are, then you're not supposed to donate the money. I'd rather have $2 from somebody who had a good heart than $100 from somebody who's a human turd. That's Aramaic. Now, listen. Simon's old nature caught him. Oh, God, no. It manifested. And he goes, let me rationalize this out. Because he was a very intelligent person. He was smart. Chris Angel is super bright. You got to be very intelligent to be a successful magician. Do you not? Yeah. So he says, hey, I'll give him money. I'll offer him money. He said, give me this authority, exousia. Hey, Peter and John, give me this authority. I want to do what you can do. That's not wrong. It's not wrong to want to have the gifts of God and to minister like someone you respect is ministering. That's not a sin. That's not a sin. He wasn't doing anything wrong, except what? He had heart problems. See, he never went through the training program. He never went into the training program because he would have never been accepted, because you had to have three qualities to get into the training program. Correct? You had to be full of the Holy Ghost. He's not. Godly wisdom. And have a reputation for honesty. He had a reputation for sorcery. He wouldn't have been let into the program yet. Some of you have not been allowed into the program yet for the same reason. You've been waiting and waiting, frustrated. Why isn't anything happening? It's not going to happen because you haven't even entered the training program yet. Simon wanted a shortcut. There are no shortcuts in the spirit world. There are in the natural world. You can take a shortcut all the time. Everybody does it. In the spirit world, no shortcuts. You'll get caught. Simon wanted a quickie. How did it happen? It was in his mind. Namidzo is something that you think about for a while, and in your mind you justify it. You know, I'd love to have this Holy Ghost power so I could lay my hands on people. Let me think about it for a second. They probably need money to get back home. I can rationalize this out in my mind. I'll just offer them money. I got plenty of it. I'm loaded. He was rich. Namidzo. He thought about it in his mind and put it into a category of that's normal. See that? It wasn't a fleeting thought. Hey, how about some money? Give me that. No, he thought about it before he made the offer. See what the text is saying? You thought it could be purchased with money. Your heart is not. Your level is off. You're not steady. Tilting from the, you're a tilter. See, this girl, the lamppost and the buildings, they're all normal, but she's tilting like Simon. He had tilted over to greed, iniquity. It was inside of him. Everything he did on the outside was fine, but inside, in our churches today, you see all kinds of people in ministry doing things for God, but inside, they're full of dead men's bones.
Yes, sir. Say that. Come on.
You know why the skeletons are all in there? See, you Pharisees, you're like whitewashed sepulchers, pretty on the outside, but if inside you're full of dead men's bones. There's skeletons in your closet.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. The reason they're there is you never went through the Holy Ghost training program.
Right.
See, those skeletons are removed before you enter the program.
Yes, that's right.
So they don't block you during your training. Yes. Serving. Serving. Not being the boss. Simon was tilting that way. Metanoeo. What does that mean? Make an about face and go the opposite direction. Repent. Every single week, I talk to someone who doesn't know what that word means. Every single week. I've been in ministry for years. Every single week of every year. Here's what they think it is. Oh, Lord, I'm so sorry. Please forgive me. That's not repenting. That's the beginning of it. Repenting is to change and go back that way.
Amen.
Repentance is not asking for forgiveness. God, I sinned, I'm sorry, please forgive me. That's not repentance. That's the beginning of it. Repent. He said, turn around and drop this whole thing and go the other direction. Where do you want him to go? Back to the training school.
Yeah.
Go there, where Stephen and Philip did. Perhaps the thought, uh-oh, paranoia means what you decided to do after thinking about it. He sat down, thought about it, it seemed rational and normal to him, and so that's what he determined to do. It wasn't a fleeting thought. He thought about it and then purposed to do it. It all happened in his mind. What was underneath the thoughts? Wow. Here's a guy who never went through the training program. He would have never been admitted in. Why? Because he had colé, bile of poison. Poisonous bile in his soul. He was in bondage to iniquity. Here's healthy bile. It's nice and yellow. Looks great, doesn't it? Almost like soup. But if it has cancer, it gets crappy looking. Yeah. Simon was the one on the right. See? Why? He never went through his training program. He wanted to be in the ministry, but he didn't want to go through the program that God requires for you to get into the ministry.
That's right, sir.
You see that? He was jumping over it. He was circumventing it. He wanted a quick fix to it. It happens all the time in our society. What's the most scary thing you can see? A celebrity getting saved. That's an oxymoron. There aren't any saved celebrities. They're all phonies. But they get saved and start babbling God speak. Yeah, we're fans of Jesus. God's a good... Oh, God, they must be saved. They're a Christian. Wow. And immediately, because they're a celebrity, the big churches take them in and they pump them out in front of the people. The reason they do that is because they're saying, hey, listen, you're just an ordinary grunt. You're not a movie star or rich. Look at this guy. If this guy who's a big shot likes Jesus and he's a big fan of Jesus, all y'all should become fans of Jesus. The churches use these phony celebrities for marketing. You don't see that?
Yeah.
Oh, look, Justin Bieber got saved. that was great. Then later on, boom, in the middle of a scandal, bringing disgrace on God and his kingdom. It happens all the time.
Yeah.
All the time. Don't ever listen to a celebrity Christian. They're not Christians. Trust me. They're all phonies. Simon wanted to be a celebrity. He was already a celebrity. Why should I go through a training program? I'm a big shot.
Right.
I'm smart.
Right.
Yeah, I'm not Fredo. I'm Warren Buffett. I've got a big mind. I'm popular. Everybody likes me. They're amazed at me. Celebrity Christians need to start right where everybody else starts.
Yeah.
In that training program. And if they don't have those three things, they don't get in the training program. The churches put them in it. They say, oh, look, go ahead and preach. Go give your testimony. Oh, they love it. Leading everybody astray. It's all a big joke. Simon said, pray for me. I think the guy repented myself. That's just my own personal opinion. We don't know what happened to him, but I like to think he became a great man of God. When they testified and preached the word, what happened when they went back to Jerusalem? Preached all the villages. Where? In Samaria. Jesus had already been there, laid the groundwork. He sowed and they reaped. That's how the gospel works. So in the end, the sower and the reaper can rejoice together, Jesus said, in eternal life. What's he saying there? Sowing has the same value as reaping. It doesn't have the cosmetic value. Sowing may be the hard work, but it's just as valuable to God as reaping, where you got a big show, demons coming out and healed and great joy in the city. Philip walked into a lottery hit. But what Philip did was no better than what the others did to lay the groundwork. What's he trying to tell you there? No ministry in God's eyes is greater than another. Each ministry has equal value to God. It's what you're called to do. If you're called to do a little thing, you'll be made a rewarder and a ruler over big things. See? It's the same to God. Well, let's look at a family that wanted to do what Simon did. They wanted to kind of, I got a training for you, program for you guys. Well, I don't want to go through a training program. No, I don't have the honesty or a reputation for being honest. I don't have any godly wisdom at all. But I've got enthusiasm. See, enthusiasm will carry you to areas angels fear to go. And that's a new convert. Have you ever seen a new convert? Extreme danger. Because they are not carnal and lukewarm like you are. So first of all, people get sick of them right away. They're excited about Jesus. Oh, and the Christians can't wait to get away from them. They walk in the mega church and see the guy that just got saved. Holy crap, and they bolt to the front. And they sit down. It's okay, don't worry about it. He'll be here in a few months. And he's there in a few months. He's there. He ran off to serve God. Oh, the enthusiasm there. I'm going to go preach to the homeless. Have you lost your mind? There are demons down on the street that don't even come here. You don't go down on the street. Preach to the homeless unless you go through God's training program, if you want any effectiveness at all. If you just want to feed them, well, that's fine. Anybody can feed. That's fine. Oh, I'm going to go. See, you can't just make it on enthusiasm. It won't work. The devil sees you coming. He'll set it up for you. He'll help you get more enthusiastic. He'll send other Christians around you who are excited like you are. He'll create a covey of excitement. And they're going to start propping ministry ideas in their head. Demons help with ministry. You don't get it, do you? Demons tell you to minister. They like a ministry. They want you to do any kind of ministry you are not prepared for. They absolutely love it. And the reason you're not prepared for it is because the imbeciles at your church that won you to Christ didn't have the intelligence to read this Bible study. You go through this training program. To get into it, you've got to have that three ingredients. Now, does this new convert have those yet?
No.
Well, if they don't have them, then they're not in the training program. First you do that, then you do that. Churches can't do that. You know why? They're so desperate for somebody that's excited about Christ. So they find this new convert. They can't believe it. I mean, they're like an anomaly. They're, oh my God, somebody actually. We got to use this guy somehow. You know, they're like megaphones. But what they're doing to the poor kid or girl or the poor gal is they're setting her up for a crushing. Because the devil's trying to help her be excited.
Yes.
Yeah, be excited. Just use your enthusiasm. Barrel on in there and get it done. You got the Lord, don't you? Yeah, you heard the preacher on TV? Just blab it out. It'll happen. Oh, really? That's all it takes? Yay! Boom, 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 boom. Smash. Truck runs over. It's all a setup. It's a demonic setup. The devil is helping you minister. Why is he able to do that? Because you didn't go through the training program.
Right.
You don't even qualify to get into the training program.
Right.
But you are qualified to make a complete ass out of yourself. That you can do. And that's what you're going to do. Simon. Embarrassed in front of everybody. You think Peter hauled him aside? No, unlikely. Paul said, rebuke him in front of everybody so the others may learn. He let Simon have it in front of everybody. Why? Because he was a public figure. He deserved it in front of everybody. He was always in front of everybody. I want you all of you to repent for those that hate me right now. Every one of you. I just felt some hate. Stop it. I'm trying to help. I'm doing it unorthodoxly. That's a term. I made it up. But it's still good material, even though I'm presenting it poorly. It's good stuff. And so do not hate me for this. Okay, now we got Simon's cousins who were over at the next county, the Sceva family. Certain vagabond Jews, that means Jews that travel around. That's like Billy Graham. He was a traveling preacher, a vagabond preacher. It's not a negative term. Jews, exorcists, took upon themselves to do... Oh, jeez. Dude, hey, listen to me. The training program, this is God's training program. You don't do it yourself. What did the Sceva brothers do? Well, they watched a YouTube video on Paul doing deliverance. They saw a YouTube video. So they said, well, that's how you do it.
Yep.
I'm going to tell you a story here with no names in it. This is a true story. Unlike all my others, this one's true. This guy travels around the country. He's in the deliverance ministry. He's pretty well known. And he travels all over the United States and Canada. He's busy and he's a workaholic. I mean, this guy works hard. And I talked to him on the phone once and I said, how did you get your ministry going? What happened? He said, well, I started watching Bob Larson videos. Who think that's on the Holy Ghost training program? See, I think the training program goes that way, then it goes that way. Don't think of YouTube videos are on there. He said, I watched the YouTube videos and saw him doing it. Then I went out and did it. Now he travels all over doing it. I've had dozens of people contact me who have been ministered in his services and different things. He's a good guy. I met him personally. He's a good guy. He's not a huckster. I mean, he's good. He's got a good heart on him. I like him. But he never had this Bible study. He didn't understand you have to start the training program here. In order to get in, you've got to have three qualities. Then you've got to serve. I don't mean watch a YouTube video and then go out and yell it, start talking to demons, and go out and stick your Bible in somebody's face. Thump. What are you doing in there? I'm drawing you in to do an exorcism on this guy. Well, nobody heard that. That one should have landed big. Yeah, demons like exorcisms. It gives them a chance to perform. It's like Shirley Temple. It's a good ship. Lollipop, I got one more. I'm not coming out. It's a good ship. Lollipop. All right, brother. I'm going to eat your feet. I'm going to go down to the lollipop. Going on the ship to the lollipop. I'm not coming out. It's all a fraud. They're manifesting to fake you out. Certain vagabond Jews watching YouTube videos watched Paul do it and say, hey, we're calling on these evil spirits to come out of them. Now listen, let's take the good side of this. Let's say they were good people, which they may have been. Let's say they were good people. And they just wanted to help somebody. They made a mistake. Simon did. They tried to circumvent God's training program, and God doesn't circumvent his programs. He doesn't allow that to happen. He doesn't bless that. You get in trouble circumventing the program. These ministers who are now renouncing their faith, the Hillsong guy, the other guy, all these guys, they never went through this training program. They went to Bible college or the seminary, then they got some other training, then they went into the ministry, then they were promoted in the ministry, and then they got into this and that. See, that's not God's program. That's not how it's done. So then they renounce their faith later. What a surprise. Not surprising. So they said, hey, we're going to help these people. We're not going to do that training program. That's too hard. Come out of there. We adjure you. Horkizo means to place an oath on something by Jesus, whom Paul preaches. Come out of there. These were seven sons of Sceva. Jew. The father was the high priest of Ephesus. This was a famous family, and they had money. They were famous. They had wealth. Everybody knew them. They were little superstars, like Simon. See, ego is the biggest problem in ministry. Your ego will destroy you. So the devil starts talking to him. They probably stuck a Bible in his head. We command you to come out of there because Paul said so. The demon goes, well, listen, Gnosko, I understand who Jesus is. I don't know him personally, but I know who he is. Okay? Epistemy, I know who Paul is. I've seen him personally. Okay, I know who Jesus is, although I don't know him personally. I know who Paul is. I've seen him personally. I've been in his services. I know who he is. Okay? Where I haven't been is, who are you guys? See, if you don't go through this training program, you're going to be shocked when you get into your ministry. It's going to sputter. It's going to flop. It's going to fall apart. You're going to wonder where the anointing is. You're going to wonder why the doors aren't opening. You're going to wonder why the doors kept slamming shut in your face. You're going to have all kinds of questions about your missionary trip to Uganda. You signed up at church to go to the missionary trip to Uganda. Why? Because you want to help. You're a good person. They were good people. See, a good person can do things wrong. It's not just bad people doing stuff wrong. Good people do stuff wrong. You had no business going to Uganda. Who are you? The man in whom the evil spirit was. Here's as clear a reference in the Bible about demon infestation anywhere in the Word. It says they were inside the guy. They were controlling his body. They were controlling his voice. He beat the living tar out of these guys. He flattened them. They were traumatizo, where we get our English word. Right. They traumatized these seven good people. Why? Because they didn't go through God's training program. They went through their own. And they failed. Let's go ahead and close here. Listen. You've been sitting around. I know you have. And you've been saying to yourself, man, things are not progressing for me. Things are not going the way I thought they would. And instead of doing it like Philip and Stephen, you did it a little bit like Simon and the sons of Sceva. You wanted to take a shortcut. You didn't want to put in the patience, the endurance, and the time to do it God's way. And you can fix that in one evening. One altar call. Peter asked Simon to fix it in one session. He told him right on the spot, repent of your wickedness. Perhaps God will forgive you for the thoughts of your heart and the iniquity and the bondage of your heart. He could have fixed it in one altar call. You can fix it tonight. You're lacking something. Which one is it? Honesty. Being full of the Spirit. Godly wisdom. Which one is it? Which one is it? Are you making all kinds of bad choices? Well, then it's got to be godly wisdom. You're getting into relationships you have no business getting into. It's got to be godly wisdom. Correct? People start questioning your character. It's got to be honesty. There's something wrong with your character. God wants to heal you of this. He needs you. I know that sounds like blasphemy. It isn't. God uses his children to bring about his will.
Amen.
He doesn't do it himself. Jesus already did it all. He did his part, and now God needs you to do your part. And you can't do it if you're lacking in one of those three areas. Okay. The first one, you've got some honesty or integrity problems. Just raise your hand so we can pray for you. That's the first one. You got some honesty or integrity issues. Okay, there's one. Next one. Come on. Yeah, it takes some guts to face this stuff. I get it. I had to do it too. I made the same mistake I've been telling you about. I got into the ministry too early. I got the living stuffing kicked out of me. I know what you're doing. I done it myself. I had integrity issues years ago. Shouldn't have done it. Come on. Raise your hand. You got honesty problems? You're giving people an impression, a false impression of yourself. That you're giving people an impression you know things you don't. That you have spiritual powers you do not have. You give people an impression that you're a know-it-all. You got honesty issues. When you get in trouble, when you get scared, you say things at work or at home that you know you shouldn't say, but you say it because you're afraid and you're trying to get out of something. Come on, you're blowing your stack at home and you're cussing somebody out and you've got honesty and integrity problems. Raise your hand, come on. You cannot get into God's training program with this problem in your soul. Come on, just raise your hand. Father God, you see these hands raised. I ask you, Holy Spirit, touch each person with their hands raised. They raise their hand because they care. Because they're brave, it takes a little bit of bravery, courage to raise your hand in public. Father God, I ask you, Holy Spirit, please bless these people right now. Touch them right now. Somebody here has got wisdom problems. You make a lot of bad choices. You say things at inappropriate times. You do things you know you shouldn't do. You get in fights or fussy arguments or doctrinal disputes with people you know you shouldn't have done it. Come on, you've got wisdom problems. You get involved in relationships. You knew you shouldn't have hung around that person. You knew something checked you in your spirit. You shouldn't have done it. You got godly wisdom problems, raise your hands. Lord, see these hands. I want these people blessed tonight, Lord Jesus. I want them blessed tonight. Thank you, Lord. Come on. You got integrity problems? Raise your hand. You got wisdom problems. You make bad choices. Personal life, business life, finances. You make bad choices with your finances. You buy stuff you have no business buying. You loan people money you shouldn't even give a penny to. You know they're not going to pay it back. You know they're going to squander it. Come on. Raise your hand, please. This is your day of reckoning before the great God of the Hebrews. He's watching you right now. The Holy Ghost is in this room right now. He comes here every week, every Thursday and Friday. He's here every week. We roll out the red carpet for him. Come on. Anybody else? Ready to shut it down here? Come on. Okay, now if you raise your hand, just stand up real quick. Stand up quickly. I'm not going to ask you to do anything. Stand up there. There you go. Now just close your eyes now. Come on, ministry team's going to come up behind you and pray for you right now. I want you to pray with me. Dear Lord Jesus, I got integrity problems. I got wisdom problems. I make bad choices. I get involved with people that I shouldn't get involved with. Lord Jesus, I'm asking you right now, please forgive me. Dear God, please forgive me. Please forgive me. If you need to leave, we love you. Thank you for coming tonight. If I offended you, I apologize for it. Lord Jesus, please forgive me. I ask you to forgive me right now. I did not go through your training program. I saw what Brother Mike was teaching. I see it now. I didn't go through the program. I didn't even qualify to enter the program. I didn't have the integrity. Somebody called me a deacon or a bishop. I should have never, come out, devil. I should have never been called a deacon or a bishop. I should have never been called a deacon or a bishop. I didn't qualify to be trained. I should have repented first, and I need to repent right now in the name of Jesus. I got bad feelings for people. I should have never been in the training program. I had aught against others. I should never be in that training program. God, forgive me, Lord. Lord, forgive me right now. The demons deceived me. They tricked me. Come on out, devil. Every spirit that lied to me and told me I was ready for ministry and I'm not, come out now. Every spirit that lied to me and said I could minister with integrity issues, come out now. Come out of me right now in the name of Jesus. Come out of my body right now in the name of the Lord. I command you, spirit of lies and deception, come out of me right now. You lack of integrity, you dishonesty, in the name of Jesus, I bind your powers. Dishonesty, come out of me right now. Faking people out, giving false impressions, I'll repent of it right this second. Ulterior motives, I command you to come out of me right this second. Ulterior motives, come out in Jesus' mighty name. Ulterior motive, I command you, come out now. Come out of my body right this second. Every spirit that lied to me, every spirit that told me I was ready for ministry and I wasn't. I wasn't ready. I'll repent of it right now. Satan, loose your hold of me at this moment. Loose your hold of me right now. I command you to loose your hold of me. I raise my hand, therefore I have the favor of God upon me. I raise my hand when Brother Mike asked me to, and I got the favor of God upon me. So you let me go right now. Come on out. Come out in Jesus' name. Come out in the name of Jesus. Right now. Wisdom. Honesty. Integrity. Come out of me. Phoniness. Phony. Lying. Lying. Come out of me. Come out in Jesus' name. Right now, I said. Acting one way, believing another. lying and cheating. Come on. Get up and move away from your family. If somebody knows who you are and they know where your skeletons are, get up right now quickly and move to the other side of the sanctuary. Move to the other side. Get away from them. If you stay there with that person, you won't do anything. You're too embarrassed. If you stay by somebody who knows all about you, you won't make your move. You'll stay there. You're embarrassed. Get up and go to the other side of the sanctuary where nobody knows you. Just repent of it. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, I am going down to Samaria and I'm going to preach Christ to them. And demons in one accord are going to scream and come out of people. And I'm going to lay hands on the sick. And they are going to recover. I'm going to lay hands on the sick. And the demons are going to come out. I'm going to go through God's training program. I'm going to become a servant of God. A servant of the Most High. I'm going to be a servant. A servant of God. Come out in Jesus' name. Come on out of there. Come out. I command you by the authority of the Word of God. Get away from your family. Go to the other side of the auditorium. Go to the sanctuary. Over here, over there. Get away from that person. Satan, I command you to come out now. Come out now. Mind control. Mind control. They had Simon. The demons had his mind. They used his mind. Simon had brain demons. They took his mind. They taught him how to think. Come on, just repent of it quickly. Let's go, saints of God. Come on. The Holy Ghost is moving. Make your move now. Make your move now. You are to be an honest servant of God. You are to have integrity as a servant of God. You are entering the training program tonight. You are going to enter that program tonight. Come on. Schizophrenia. Bipolar. Schizoaffective. Psychoses. I bind your power tonight. I command you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Come out. Come out of that brain. The demons had Simon's brain. They put thoughts in his mind. They made a fool out of him. Come out, bipolar. Come out. Every spirit, come out. Demon of cigarettes, come out in Jesus' name. Come on, them lungs. Demon of cigarettes, come out now. Get out of there. Come up. Smoking pot. Smoking pot. Smoking pot draws in demons faster than any drug. If you smoke pot, you are a demonic fool. If you're smoking pot, you will pay a price you will never believe. They get into your brain. The demons get into your brain through pot. Come on. Simon had demons in his brain. They were in his brain. They controlled his thoughts. They're controlling your thoughts. Fight back right now. Fight back. All believers will lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Put your hands on your head and command the demons that Simon had. Come out! Come out of my head! Come out of my brain! YouTubers, put your hand on your body. Put it right there. Fight back now. Hurry. Come on. Stand up and raise your hands. Lord Jesus, help me. That's an easy prayer to pray. You can stand up. Lord Jesus, help me. Help me, Lord. God, help me. Help me, Lord. Help me. Help me. Help. Come on. Pray like Peter. Pray like Peter. Help. Help me. Help. Help me, Lord. Come on. This isn't Calvary Chapel. Come on. Pray with your guts. Help me. Lord, help me. Help. Help. Help me. Lord, save me. God, help me. God, help me. Come out, devil. Tell him to come out. Come out. Come out. Come out right now. What's wrong with that kid? What's wrong with that boy? Nothing? Anybody need prayer here? Prayer? Prayer? Just ask God to forgive you like that. Jesus, forgive me. Those prayers work wonders. Just do what I'm doing. God, save me. God, save me. Help me. Help. Help. Come on. Anybody can pray like I'm praying. Anybody can pray like me. Help.
You pray for him?
Yeah. Hey, what's going on? Mike.
Hey, hi, Terry.
What's wrong with you?
I was a deacon once and made a hash of it, just like you were talking about.
What caused it, though?
I was not mature enough and got into it too quickly.
Got what? Too quickly?
Yeah.
Did you have integrity problems?
Mostly ego problems.
Ego? But, okay. Yeah. That's easy to repent of and get healed.
Okay.
You just raise your hands like this. See? Lord Jesus, I bind this ugly spirit of pride in my body. I bind that spirit of pride. And I command that ego and that pride to come out of me now. I command you to come out of me now. Come out of me now. Right now. Arrogance. Ego. Lust. Arrogance. Come. There he is. He's right there. He just jumped. Come on out of that body. There he is. There he's coming up now. Here he comes. He's coming up now. There he is. He's coming up now. Hold that. He's coming up. Go. Go. Come on. There he is. Keep coughing. Come out, you rotten devil. Come out, you rotten devil. Come out of that body right now. Come out of there. Come out, you rotten spirit. Get out of that body. Arrogance and pride, I bind your power. Lust, come out of that body right now. Go, get out of my stomach. Come out of my stomach right now. Poison, come out. Ego, come out of that body. Narcissism, come out of that body. Get out of the body right now. Come on. Get out of there. Come on out. Get out. Leave. Come out. Next one. Next. Next. Childhood fears. Come out. Come out. Childhood fears. Right there it is. Come out right now. Childhood fears. Come on now. There he is. Here he comes. Here he comes. Coming up right now. There they come. There they come. Come up. Next. There it comes. Keep coughing. Come on, that body right now. Let this man of God go. Let him go, devil. Let this man of God go. You know he has a ministry. You know God's going to use him. Come out of him right now. Stop lying. Stop lying. There he comes. Glory to God. Come on out. Get out of that body. Come out of body right now. Next. Come out of there right now. Masturbation. Come out. Go. Get out of the body. Come on out. Come on out. Quickly come out. Come out of there. Next one. Go. There they go. Glory to God. Come on. Out you go, you rotten devil. You have the anointing. Go ahead and use it quickly. Anything you want will go. Anything. Come out of me right now. Anything you want. Anger. In the name of Jesus, you heard him. Come out of him right now. Anger, you heard him come out. There it comes. Anger. Anger. Arrogance. Anger. Come out in Jesus' mighty name. No, next one, that's not all of them. There's more anger in there. Come out of there right now. Come out of me right now. Satan, come out right now. All of you. All of it. Come on. Get out of my body right this second. I want you out right now. Do you hear me? Come on right now. Go. Come on right now. Go. Right now, quickly. Quickly. There it comes. Glory to God. Go in Jesus' name. Go in Jesus' holy name. Come out next. Who's next? You got the ability to have anything you want right now. Take it. Anything come out. You don't want in there. Anything.
Distrust.
What?
Distrust.
Distrust of?
My spouse.
Your spouse?
Yeah.
Okay. Come out. Your spouse did what to you? What'd she do to you?
She cheated on me.
Okay, what's her name?
Vesna.
Vesna? Okay, ready? Father God, we're going to turn Vesna over to you. We're going to release him from her husband. And we're going to give her to you. And you heal her. And he's going to trust you to do it. Even though he doesn't trust her. He's going to repent of it right now. Vesna, go. Come on out. There she comes. Come on. Come on out, Vesna. Come out. There she comes. Come out of there. Lack of trust. Come out. Fear. Fear of her doing it again. Come out of me right now. Fear of her doing it again. Go. There it is. Come on out right now. Quickly. Come out. Right now. All of it. Fears. Fear of what else? Fear of what else?
Fear of being a screw up.
Okay. That's a legitimate fear.
Yeah.
Insecurity in Jesus' name. Come on out. Childhood insecurity. Come on. Come on. Every demon from his dad, go. Dad, come on out. There it is right there. Dad, come on. Mother. Every spirit from mother. Come on out right now. Go. Come out quickly. Come out quickly. Come on now. Listen to me. Listen to me carefully. If you dishonored your parents, the devil put a curse on you. The devil put a curse on you. If you dishonored your parents, let's repent of it right now. Let's repent of it right now. Father God, I break this curse off of me because I dishonored my parents. I ran my big fat mouth. I disobeyed them. I cursed them. I sassed them. I talked back to them. I brought a curse on myself. I repent of it right now. In the name of Jesus, I repent and change. And I break this curse off of me. I break this mother, father curse off of me right now. And the result of that curse, I break that curse off my finances. I break that curse off my relationships. I break that curse off my health. I break that curse off my health. I got a curse because I dishonored my mother and father. Thus saith the Lord, thou shalt not dishonor thy mother nor thy father. It does not matter what your parents did. If you dishonored them, a curse fell on you. Your finances, your health. Your health, your finances is in jeopardy. It's in jeopardy. Curses are real. Curses are dangerous. Curses are dangerous. They will destroy you. If you bring a curse on yourself, you got to break that curse off tonight. And the results of the curse. You must break that curse off tonight. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I repent over hurting my mom and dad. I repent over hurting my stepmom and dad. I repent over hurting my adopted mom and dad. I repent of it in the name of Jesus. I'm sorry for what I did, Lord. And I break this curse off of me. The curse of disobedience and rebellion and arrogance. I break it off of me. And I command my body to heal its spinal cord. I command you to be released from this curse. Release me from this curse in the name of Jesus. Sexual perversion, I break the curse. There it comes, come on out. Come out, there it comes, come out of there. Come out, there it comes, come on out. Keep coming. Come out quicker. Come out quicker. 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 Come out quicker. Go. Come out quicker. Sexual perversion, go. Perversion, go. Get out of my body. There he comes. Perversion, I command you. Go in Jesus' name. Leave the spinal cord. Leave the bones. Leave the joints. Come out now. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Curse, I command you, break off. I command you, curse, break off. Break. I command this curse to break off by the blood that Jesus shed. All sexual perversion. Go. All sexual desires, adultery, lesbianism, pornography, come out, come out, come out, come out, come out, come out, every porno movie, every DVD, pornographic masturbation. Come out. Masturbating to porn. Come out. Come on now. You're going to get delivered tonight. You get healed tonight. You get delivered. This isn't Calvary Chapel. This isn't the Episcopal Church. This isn't the Lutheran Church. Come on. Repent of it. This isn't a church at all. It's a healing center. Satan, I command you to loose your hold now. I command you to loose your hold. Get out of my spine. Come out of my brain. Hurry up. I want every demon out. Not most of them. I said I want every demon out. Not most of them. Every one of them out. Get out of my body right now. Here he comes. Come on out of there. Hurry up. Come on out real quickly. Get out of my body. I want all the demons out. All of them out of that stomach. You food hog. Come out of that body right now. Go. Get out of that body right now.
Get out of my body in Jesus' name.
Go.
Get out of my body.
Lust and food, porn, greed, money, material things. I command you to be broken. I command you to break. Negative thoughts, lies, delusions. I command you to break. Break your power. Break in Jesus' mighty name. Break, I command you. I command every spirit, not half of them, not most of them, every spirit. Yo, get out of there right now. Get out of that stomach. Get him out of there. Yeah, there he is. Come on out. Get out of the body quickly. Come on. Get out of there. You release this teacher of the gospel right now. You need to release the man of God, you filthy devil. You think you own him. You do not own him. Give up. You're going to give up. Give his health back. Give his mind back. You stole everything from him. Now give it back. Give it back. He commands you to give it back. Give it back. I'm repenting of my sin. And when I do, the favor of God comes upon me. The favor of God comes upon me if I will repent. Therefore, the demons have no legal right on me anymore. Because I repented. I'm changing. I'm doing what's right. I'm entering the training program with integrity and honesty, filled with the Holy Ghost. Filled with the Holy Ghost. I receive the Holy Ghost right now. Take a big breath. Take a big breath. I receive the Holy Ghost. Ready? Breathe. Come on, YouTube. I receive the Holy Ghost. Breathe. Glory to God. I receive the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Breathe. He'll come right in. Breathe. I receive the gifts of the Spirit. Those are mine. They belong to me. God gave them to me. Breathe. I breathe in the power of the Holy Ghost. Breathe. Glory. Breathe. In the power of the Spirit. Honesty. Integrity. Wisdom. Full of the Holy Ghost. Now I qualify to enter the training program of God. I'm qualified to enter the training program of God Almighty. Like Philip and Stephen, not like Simon. Not like the sons of Sceva. I don't want to be like them. No! I don't want to be like them. No, I said. I want to be like Philip and Stephen and humble myself and be a servant. A servant in the school of the Holy Ghost. Take a big breath. Breathe in the Holy Spirit. Breathe. Pneuma. Pneuma. The breath of the Spirit. I receive it. And now every demon, come out of me. Every lie, come out of me. Every filthy thought, come out of me. Perverted thoughts, come out of me. You stinking liar. I am not a pervert. You are. I am not a liar. You're lying. I repent of lying. You're a liar, you rotten demons. You're a pervert, you rotten demons. Not me. This is my chance. This is my opportunity. When you get a chance to repent and in a service that has the moving of the Spirit in it, you don't understand. You need to take advantage of it. 99% of churches all over America don't have the Holy Ghost moving in their services. They do not have the Spirit of God moving. The Spirit of God moves in every service here because we cater to Him. We cater to Him. We roll out the red carpet. Churches don't do that. They have their own programs. We don't do that here. We roll out the carpet for the Spirit of the Lord. He wants someone with a broken heart. He wants someone who will change and will repent. That's the person He's looking for. That's the person He wants. That's the person He cares about. That's the one He's after. A broken-hearted person with tears of repentance, they get miracles from God. They get miracles from God. People who think they're fine and just sit there doing nothing, they get nothing from God. Did you hear me? They get nothing from God. They just get themselves. They just get themselves. Let me tell you something, friend. Let me be honest with you. You've had enough of yourself. You've had enough of yourself. I'm speaking for you right now. You've had enough of yourself. You want to turn your life over to the Lord. You want Holy Ghost stuff, not you. Tonight, I lay myself on the altar of sacrifice. I lay myself down there. And I repent of living a life self-centered, self-absorbed. I repent of that evil. That is evil. Satan's greatest sin was arrogance. His greatest sin was being self-absorbed. He was self-absorbed. Pride was his downfall. Pride. Pride got him. It will not get you. It will not get you. YouTubers, you will change now. You will repent right now. Get out of the body. Come on, body, quickly. Fear, come on. Fear. Fear of man, go. Fear of man, intimidation, insecurity, go. Come on out. Come on out of there. Right now, quickly. Insecurity, go. Intimidation, go. Come out in Jesus' name. Come on, you got the Holy Ghost. You're as strong as anyone when you have the Spirit of the Lord. You're as strong as anyone. You are not a weak, gutless coward. No, you are not. You are not. You're a fighter. You're a freedom fighter. You're a freedom fighter. You're going to set yourself free first, and then you will free others. You will not die. You will not die without fruit. You will have fruit. Satan, come out. Come out right now. I bind your power. Come on out. Come out. Come out, Lord. What's wrong with your leg?
Been walking crooked.
Huh?
Been walking crooked.
When did it start?
A few days ago.
What happened a few days ago? Anything traumatic happen or unusual?
No.
Anything bad happened to you?
Oh, my blood pressure's been up.
A few days ago? Why? What drove that up?
Stress.
Over.
I think I'm tired of living in my RV.
And what were the thoughts you were having in the RV?
Oh, it's such a mess. It needs to be cleaned. I need repairs on it.
And what were the thoughts you were having? The thoughts about living in there. What were you saying to yourself? They were personal thoughts.
Why am I still living here?
Okay, why you're still living in, and you answer yourself how?
That's what I wanted.
You want to live there?
Well, I wanted to do outreaches and stuff. I wanted to travel.
Okay, now that was out of God's will, right?
That was what?
That wasn't God's will. Did you go through your training? Yeah, at the time you thought it was, but had you gone through your training program?
No.
Okay, so now you know a revelation that was all wrong.
Yeah.
And that's why it wasn't blessed.
Right.
Correct? Or am I on the right track?
Well, you know, the way I got it was crazy. Because I walked into Special RV, and I had the impression that God can go in here and tell them they're going to sell you an RV. And that's just what I did.
That's what happened, right?
The guy floated me along to qualify for the credit union.
Okay. And then that was a miracle.
Okay.
Correct?
Yeah.
Because that don't happen to anybody.
Right.
But the purpose of it, you were wrong. You weren't supposed to be traveling around doing ministry if you hadn't gone through your training program. Correct?
Right.
So the purpose of it was wrong, but the miracle was legitimate. He gave you the RV.
Right.
Correct? Correct? Right. Am I off here or on?
No, you're on.
Okay. Close your eyes then. Dear Jesus, I am so sorry. I violated the Bible study tonight. I got into the ministry without going through the training program. I thought the miracle of the RV meant that I was supposed to go in the ministry, and I was wrong because it never happened. It wasn't blessed, and I hadn't gone through the training program. I hadn't gotten delivered. I hadn't developed my integrity. I hadn't gotten my giftings. I just went and did it. The devil tricked me, and I see it now. And in the name of Jesus, I'll repent of it right this second. Every spirit that deceived me into going into the ministry, like Brother Mike was talking tonight, demons love people going into the ministry. He tricked me. Come out of there. There he comes. Come out of there right now. Get out of there. Come out of his leg right now. Come out of his leg. Come out of that leg right now. Come out of his leg. There he is. Come out of the leg. Come out of his leg right now. Get out of that body right now. Hurry up. Come out of that leg. Come out of his leg right now. Get out of that leg right now. Come out. Get out of there. I repent of ministry. I repent of ministry. I repent of doing my own ministries. Get out of that body right now. Come out of there quickly. I repent of doing my own ministries. Come out now, devil.
Come out now, devil.
You religious spirit. Come on. There he is. Here he comes. There he is right there. The religious spirit. You caught him. Religious demon. Come out of me. The religious spirit. Come out of my leg. Right now. Get out of my leg. Come out of my brain.
Come out of my brain.
Stop deceiving me. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for the miracle of the RV. Forgive me for the ministry thoughts. I was wrong. There it comes. Come on out. There he comes. Come on out quickly. Get out of that body right now. There it goes. Leg healed. Heal in Jesus' name. Deceiving spirit. Out. Come on out. Deceiving spirit. Come on my back. Come on out. Quickly. Come out of my body right now in the name of Jesus. Hurry. Get out of there. I got tricked. I didn't get into the training program. And I never went through the training program. I wasn't serving. Come out, you lying spirit. You religious spirit. You church spirit. Church demons, come out of me right now. Religious demons, come out of me right now. Hurry up, come on out. Religion. Religion, come on me. Come on my feet. Come on my leg right now. Clear. Come on out quickly. Come on out. Come out. I bind the power of overeating. Overeating, I bind your power. Come out. Come out. Poison, come out of my body right now. Overeating. Overeating. Food poison. Come out. Come out right now. Hurry. Come out of my body. There it comes. Come on out quickly. Come out quickly. Come out quickly. Come out quickly. Feeling sorry for myself. Living in an RV. God, forgive me. God, forgive me for feeling sorry for myself. God, have mercy on me. God, have mercy on me. Oh, Savior. There it comes. God, have mercy on me. Lord Jesus, save me. Lord Jesus, I throw myself at your feet. Son of God. The Son of God, heal. Son of God, heal. Heal my mind. No more deception. No more lies. No more fake ministries. No. No more fake ministries. No more. No more fake ministries. No more lies. No more religious crap. I've had enough of it. Come out. Get out of my body right now. Satan, listen to me carefully. I hate you. Satan, I hate you, I said. I hate you. Come out of me right now.
Come out of me now, Jesus. Come out of me now in Jesus' name.
Come out of there.
Come out of me now in Jesus' name.
Go. There he comes. There you go. You got the anointing. Take it. There you go. Come on. Come out. Go. Now. Get out of that body. Get out of that body right now. Come out of there. I am not going to serve the devil one more day, not one more minute. I'm getting a divorce. Get out of there. I'm getting a divorce from religious delusions. Delusions. Out you go. You get out of my RV, you rotten spirit. I want you out of my RV right now. Get out of that RV. Don't you dare come in there. Don't you come in it again. Get out of my RV in the name of Jesus. Hurry up. Get out of my RV. I say get out of there right now. Get out of the body. Hurry up. Come on. Come on. All the disappointments, all the bad men, all the heartache. Go. Come out. Get out of that stomach. Get out of there. Come out right now. Go. Hurry up. Get and go. Come on and go. Go now. There it comes. Get out of his leg. Come out of his tummy. Come out of his chest. Hurry. Let this man of God go. Let that woman of God go. Let her go. Let him go. Let her go. Come on out. Get out of there. I command you, Satan, loose your hold. Take your filthy hands on my RV. Take your hands on my money. Take your hands off my friends. I command you to loose me right now. Every snake in my body, every lust for food, I command you to go. Wait, I bind your power. I command you to fall off of me. Wait, leave me now in Jesus' name.
completely renounce Jesus.
You're trying to kill me with heart disease and high blood pressure. How dare you? Come at him.
Come out now. Jesus.
High blood pressure spirit, come out.
Come out now.
Go. Hurry up. Out. Get out of that body. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, dear Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Streamers, listen to me. Go to the website real quick. HardcoreChristianity.com. Go to the website and hit the teaching button. Read the article, How Satan Controls the Mind. Read the other article, Satan's Counterattack. You will be hit within 24, 48 hours of this service. You will be hit. The devil will try to steal what you got tonight. You must be ready for his counterattack. The teaching button on the website. Next Friday, I'll have another unusual teaching for you. Friday nights at 7 o'clock Pacific and Mountain Time, 10 p.m. Eastern Time, youtube.com/House of Healing AZ. We'll have the teachings on there. Send me an email, mike@hardcorechristianity.com. If you have comments, suggestions, prayer requests, or you need the self-deliverance list, mike@hardcorechristianity.com. Thursday night is our healing room with our super-powered preacher, Rick Cat. Thursday night, 7 p.m. If you're a Christian, you have a mental illness, don't stay at home. Please come get healed. Thursday night at 7 p.m., our mental illness healing class. I'll be back next Friday. See you next time.